Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
A lot of people followed the case of the so-called Green Beret murders, as some people referred to the killing of the wife and two little girls of Dr. Jeffrey McDonald at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, in 1970, and a lot more have interested themselves in the event since the publication of Joe McGinniss's book, Fatal Vision, a book which the author began believing in the innocence of the man he was writing about, and ended not only by agreeing that, in fact, Jeffrey McDonald had killed his own wife and children, but in producing even more evidence than that which persuaded the jury in March of 1982 to find Dr. McDonald, widely described as the All-American Boy, now demoted to All-American Killer. Not what one would have expected of a young man voted most popular and likeliest to succeed by his high school class, who went on to Princeton University, to medical school at Northwestern, to the Green Berets, to the killing of his wife and children, to beating the rap for almost 10 years, during which, among other things, he gave courses at the University of California on child abuse, to trial and finally to jail somewhere in Texas, serving three consecutive life terms. Mr. McGinniss's fascinating book does more merely than to recount an extraordinary 10 years in the life of an extraordinary man. He raises the question of the reliability and indeed even of the desirability of so-called expert psychological testimony at such trials. You see, at the pretrial hearings of Dr. McDonald, one psychiatrist, and he is here today, testified that it was all but inconceivable that someone of the character and background and personality of Jeffrey McDonald could have behaved as charged. A second psychiatrist also here figured similarly in the case, and the long shadow of Hinckley, who tried to kill the president, was found not guilty after an abundance of psychiatric testimony hangs over the whole question we seek to explore during this hour. Joe McGinniss is, of course, the author of The Selling of the President, which was a bestseller for 7 months in 1969. That was his first book. His fourth, Going to Extremes, was a nonfiction exploration of Alaska. He teaches at Bennington College. Dr. Robert Sadoff got his MD at the University of Minnesota and a degree in psychiatry from the University of California at Los Angeles. He is associated with the Albert Einstein Hospital, Philadelphia Psychiatric Center. Dr. Seymour Halleck received his degrees from the University of Chicago and is professor of psychiatry at the University of North Carolina and author of 8 books, including Law and the Practice of Psychiatry. The high intellectual point of the proceedings came when the prosecutor told the jury Dr. McDonald's murder trial, quotes, "If we can prove that he did it, then we don't need to prove that he's the kind of guy who could have done it." I should like to begin by asking Mr. McGinniss, is this remark likely to go down in history alongside the observation that the emperor had no clothes and that the reason to rob banks is that there's money there?
Well, I think it has a certain pithiness which it shares with those remarks, but I think in the context in which it was made, it was an extraordinarily useful and effective thing for the prosecutor to say, because for 7 weeks these jurors had sat in the courtroom in North Carolina and had seen Jeffrey McDonald portrayed as the All-American Boy, as you described him in the introduction, a man who could not possibly have committed these monstrous crimes. The physical evidence was so overwhelming against him that the only defense that he had was really a character defense, and that was, in other words, to say, I am not the kind of man who could have done this awful thing. Look at me, I stand for all that's right about America. I am sane, I am more than sane, I am wonderful, I am the kind of man every mother hopes her son grows up to be. I could not have killed my wife and children. That was on one side of the scale. On the other side was the massive amount of physical evidence, which ultimately persuaded the jury. So the prosecutor, in his closing argument, wanted to focus the jury's attention solely on the physical evidence, which, in his opinion, which the jury concurred with, proved Dr. McDonald to be guilty.
But the latter representation, the judge didn't permit to be made, so how could it have figured?
Well, even without permitting expert psychiatric testimony in the trial, there had been character testimony by people who had known him for 15 years.
You're referring here now to layman's testimony.
Yes. Yes.
Why don't we ask you, Ms. McGinniss, before we introduce Dr. Halleck, Dr. Sadoff, to explain what it is that you are here to contend on the matter of the relevance of, quote, expert psychiatric testimony at such a trial as you've just written this remarkable book about.
Well, I'm not contending that in all cases psychiatrists should be barred from a courtroom. I think that there is a place for psychiatric evaluation. I think that there's a certain weight that can be given to it. I would contend, if anything, that in this particular case, the judge who presided over the trial was correct in his decision to exclude psychiatric testimony because
he was rather nervous about it, wasn't he?
Well, he said it was a very close question. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, he was unanimously upheld by the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals and by the Supreme Court, so his judgment was proven to be correct. But he admitted that it was a close question. He could have had eminent psychiatrists who had worked with Dr. McDonald going back to 1970, and as recently as days before the trial began, come in and say, this man, in my opinion, does not have a personality consistent with that that could have resulted in these crimes. In other words, I don't think he could have done it. He also would have had the prosecution introduce psychiatric testimony from people who examined McDonald during the trial, saying, not only is he the kind of guy who could have done it, he's the kind of guy who almost certainly did do it. And the judge felt that this would simply have confused the jury. They wouldn't have known how much weight to give to whose credentials. It would have been conflicting hired gun testimony from either side, which would have crossed each other out. In the end, he said, we'd be sitting here until Christmas listening to these experts argue, and it still doesn't change whether type A blood is found here or whether type B blood is found there. And I would contend that in that particular instance, the judge, Franklin T. Dupree, was correct in his decision not to permit psychiatric testimony.
I'm going to go to Dr. Howell just 1 second, but I want to ask you this. Does everything that you say depend heavily on this being so open and shut a case?
No, I don't think so.
So even in close calls on the matter of guilt, you would still generalize on the matter of the expert testimony of psychiatrists, as you just have done?
Well, when it's to be used to advocate the position that a man is incapable, lacks the capacity, or probably does not have a personality consistent with the action performed, I would think that it's getting into the realm of speculation. I think that it's the opposite side of the insanity defense coin. You can bring in psychiatrists to say this man was not sane at the time these actions were committed, but to bring in a psychiatrist to say this man could not have committed these actions is something quite different.
So if Ronald Reagan were had up on the charge that he had committed an act of compassion, he would have been organically innocent, right?
Well, it depends on one's point of view, I suppose.
Dr. Halleck, I'm not sure what position you're going to take here, so I'm intrigued to know what it is. But would you mind just starting out by telling us briefly how it is that you said, quote, based on my examination, I was fairly certain he was not directly involved in the killing of his family, but that he did feel guilty because he had not been able to save them. Now, what led you to something that turned out to be so incorrect?
Well, first of all, I don't think I said that. I don't think
it's in quotes in the book, but there's no index.
Well, there may be a confusion between Dr. Halleck and Dr. Sadoff.
I apologize if I mistyped it, but one of you said it.
In no way would I have ever said that he was the kind of person who could not have done this.
No, that was Dr. Sadoff. Oh, yeah, I did. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to reread the one. Here's what you said. I would conclude that there was only an extremely remote possibility that a person of his type would commit a crime of this type. Certainly no one with Dr. McDonald's personality organization has yet ever been known to commit such a crime.
That I did say, and certainly in my experience and in my readings, I have never heard of a person with the findings I saw who had done this sort of thing. It's always a probability statement. The most you can say is how probable this was. And based on my findings, I thought it was extremely improbable. Now, let me make clear, psychiatrists cannot tell who's telling the truth, and anybody can kill. But I think the probabilities in this case were remote.
Well, since we're discussing psychiatry and the law on which you've written so much, given that you're dealing only with probabilities, what is the relevance of a probability? The probability is that nobody will commit murder, since there are more people than there are murders, only just a few more. But given that, do you take a general position in your books about the admissibility or desirability of court's expert?
This was a very unusual situation. I think it's extremely rare that psychiatrists would get involved in this kind of case. I think the issue here was such an unusual crime, so much concern about who could have done this sort of thing, what kind of individual, so much concern with trying to develop a motivation, that it probably was very useful for the court to look at the issue of what kind of person this was.
You mean given the fact that there was no obvious motive, therefore, the original court, the army court that looked into it, wanted to find out what possibly could have been a motivation, whence the relevance of expert psychiatric professionals.
Let me say it has a tiny bit of relevance. I think psychiatrists could have been useful in this case, and if they had been allowed to testify, in terms of pointing out that a motivation had not been discovered. And as far as I'm concerned, and this is probably as much as I can say about it, I think to this day we still don't know anything about the motivation, if indeed he did it.
Would you agree with that, Dr. Sadoff?
I would agree generally that we in psychiatry can give some help to the courts in various questions that they have in criminal law as well as in civil law. And I think if we're talking about psychiatry and the law, we ought to expand it to the whole realm that we can help people. And I do think that as psychiatrists who work in the field, and I know Dr. Halleck has seen thousands of people as I have, who have been involved in crimes, and many who have been involved in murders, and we have developed a kind of an experience of seeing the kinds of people who kill. And I think from that standpoint, without ever talking about Dr. McDonald, I think we can talk about people who are accused of killing. And whether they fit into a framework or a typology of people who are likely to do certain things under certain conditions. And I think having seen so many and testified on so many in the past, both for prosecution and for the defense and for the court, I think one can develop an expertise in saying that this either fits psychologically or it doesn't fit psychologically. And all in court one is really doing is creating a reasonable doubt.
Well, let me put the question hypothetically, if I may. Let's assume that the district attorney was looking for the murderer of this particular woman, and there were 40 people who might have done it. Do we all concede that it would be useful for him to consult somebody like you? With backgrounds, psychological backgrounds, to the extent they were available of these 40 people, on the basis of which you could say it's likelier that somebody in this group did it rather than somebody in this group did it. Would you go so far?
Yes, I would, because that's going the opposite way from the way that we usually go in terms of having someone who has done it. Yeah. And you take a man like Dr. Brussell, who is now dead, wrote a book called The Casebook of a Crime Psychiatrist, where he goes that direction, and he says he tries to help law enforcement authorities find the kind of person who is likely to have committed a killing or a rape or some other terrible crime. And I have done that in the past too, but not as much as I have once they have someone that they've caught, to evaluate him and to see what kind of a person it is, how it fits into what happened to the person who was either killed or harmed in some way.
So it's a legitimate instrument of sleuthing then.
Yes.
Would you agree?
Yes, but it leads to varying conclusions. Since Dr. Brussell's name has been brought up, I should point out that He was a psychiatrist employed by the prosecution in the McDonald case. He examined McDonald during trial in 1979 and came up with conclusions radically different from those. In fact, quite the opposite of those.
He was obviously right. But the point is that we had in Dr. McDonald an extremely difficult case. But we want to try to preserve the following distinction, namely, should testimony from expert psychiatrists be considered as dispositive? Answer, no. Is it useful? Answer, maybe yes. Useful, for instance, in leading you to more probable culprits and less probable culprits. But that's only in the initial stages, right?
That's what I would say.
I would want to argue that this is one of the less useful and more exotic uses of psychiatry in the courtroom. We really don't have very much expertise on this, and the most you can ever do is make probability statements about anybody. I don't think this issue arises very much in the courts, and I think there are many, many more areas in which psychiatrists really can be involved in legal issues much more usefully, legal and correctional issues more usefully.
Oh, well, certainly this is not a form designed to question all the uses of psychiatry, but since this is an engrossing episode, and you all were so intimately involved in it, we may as well milk it for what is there that we can all learn from it, right? And, well, let me ask you this question, Dr. Halleck. When you examine somebody in this kind of situation, do you begin by informing yourself of the circumstantial case against him so as to tune your own thinking, i.e., in one case you might be asked, is Dr. Armstrong a likely killer? To which the answer would be very clearly no. In the second case, you would say, Dr. Armstrong apparently killed these people. How can I, as a psychiatrist, account for this odd seizure?
It may be surprising, somewhat surprising to you, Mr. Buckley, but I paid very little attention to the details of the crime. My function is just that of being a psychiatrist, and it's to report to whoever is hiring me.
Who were you retained by?
I was retained by the defense. Mm-hmm. What I saw in this man, to try and describe what capacities or incapacities he had, and to try and describe his personality.
Would it have been professionally useful for you, before you examined him, to familiarize yourself more with the details?
I had familiarized myself with some details, but primarily for the purpose of examining him, namely to see how he would respond when I asked him about these details.
Mm-hmm. But the details were supplied in that case by whom?
The details were supplied by the transcripts I had of the previous trials and by his attorney.
By his attorney. See, my question about the usefulness of psychiatry under these circumstances is, how do you know when the details you're provided with are accurate? How can you tell, A, when the patient is telling you the truth? As in 1970, Jeffrey McDonald told Dr. Sadoff a number of things which turned out later to be untrue, but Dr. Sadoff would have had no way of knowing that at the time. Mm-hmm. Might not this influence one's diagnosis?
We can't tell who's telling the truth.
Well, we can tell in a certain case. Yeah. In 1970, Jeffrey McDonald tells Dr. Sadoff that his wife took a class in literature. It turns out later it was in child psychology, a not insignificant distinction, I think. He also tells Dr. Sadoff that one of the four intruders may have been a male, not a female, as he had first said. He also told Dr. Sadoff that he had suffered 16 stab wounds in the chest. Now, this was proven demonstrably false. He suffered only three. There's a major difference here, but Dr. Sadoff would have no way of knowing this.
I want to comment, but not about that. I want to comment about what a psychiatrist does in a situation of that type. First, I think we should say that this was a most unusual and rare kind of case, and that's why you have your book. The bread and butter of what I do is far different from that. It has to do with people who are accused of killing and either admit that they have or the evidence is overwhelming against them.
A Hinckley type.
Then it's a matter of why did they do it? Were they insane? Were they under the influence of alcohol, drug? Was it a diminished kind of a capacity to do what they did? And that's really why a psychiatrist is called 95% of the time.
You mean, in other words, to inform the jury as to whether or not there was moral responsibility?
Yes.
Sort of McNaughton-type responsibility.
In that sense, I get my data from the person who calls me, prosecutor or a defense. Now, if it's from a defense counsel, I say, I want any statement he made to the police. I want the police investigation data. I want everything I can have before I ever see him, so I know what you have on him. And when he tells me something that is inconsistent with what you have, whether yours is right or wrong, I can at least confront him with the inconsistencies.
But how can you know what the prosecutor's case is, except to the extent that it's public, since there's no discovery in criminal proceedings?
There is discovery.
Where?
At least in Pennsylvania. And there is in New Jersey, too. Yes, there is. And I always get what I can.
I didn't know
as
that.
As much as I can before I see the person. Now, there are some things they can withhold to the last minute, and there's a kind of a gradation of discovery, but I can get a statement made to the police, I get an autopsy. I mean, if somebody tells me that he stabbed a person and it's actually that the person was shot, I can see that there's a difference.
And maybe you can't interrogate the prosecutor, surely?
I can't interrogate the prosecutor, but I can get his data through court-ordered discovery, and it's always done.
But in 1970, in the McDonald case, this did not occur. I mean, there was no way for you to immediately check the veracity of his statement to you that he had suffered 16 stab wounds in the chest.
Because there was nobody there saying, no, it wasn't 16, it was 3.
Yeah. That's right.
Now, and sometimes you can't check the specific veracity of what a person tells you. But mostly in cases where there is some data that a person was involved in the crime, you can. Now, sometimes a person tells me, I didn't do it, and there is evidence that is overwhelming against him. And I tell him, well, I can't help you, because if your attorney wants me to say you were insane, that is a particular state of mind with reference to that particular act.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't commit that act, then you could have been crazy as anything, but still not legally insane.
Mm-hmm. So therefore, your usefulness there is an attempt to build a bridge between the immunities that are conferred in virtue of insanity,
yes,
and the case that the prosecution wants the jury to rule on.
That's one role that I would have, yes.
One role. And the other one being what?
There would be one role, would be, is he competent to proceed in the law? Does he know what's happening to him? Can he confer with counsel in preparing a defense? Or is he incompetent and must go back to the hospital for treatment? I may have a role to decide with the judge, or help the judge make a decision where he belongs. Should he be in a hospital? Should he be on probation? Should he be in a prison?
Would you typically find yourself arguing with another psychiatrist who's maintaining the opposite?
I'll be honest with you. Most people look at insanity as a Hinckley type.
Yeah.
85% of people who are found legally insane, there is no contest. The psychiatrists on both sides agree about diagnosis. And they stipulate, they walk through, they talk. So that the ones like Hinckley are rare cases, especially where you have the battle of the experts, which becomes blown out of all proportion, I think.
So would Patty Hearst be in that
another
category?
One. Yes, sir. Would.
Uh-huh. Let me get back to this truthfulness issue, and let's try and leave Dr. McDonald out of it. In my work with criminals, and I work mostly in correctional settings, I assume that people are going to lie to me. And I'm not really concerned with discerning the truth ultimately. I'm concerned with how people respond when I point out that they're not telling the truth, or when I point out inconsistencies. And I'm much more interested in the process by which they go about telling that story, or if you will, the process by which they go about lying, than whether or not they're telling the truth. I'm really simply trying to say, what kind of person is this?
Well, let me ask you this, Doctor. How can the tradition have arisen that you can be retained by one or the other side, who are bound together only in an adversarial relationship, and still serve an apparently disinterested end, which is the ascertaining of the truth?
It's very difficult. I wish we did not have to do this in an adversarial system, but it is the one way in which psychiatrists do get involved in these legal issues.
Well, couldn't the court hire you?
It's done in some instances. It usually has not worked out terribly well when they do.
Is that permit? Or do you, if a court seeks expert psychiatric testimony, must the defense attorney acquiesce in the arrangements?
Depends on the jurisdiction. In New Jersey, if the defense pleads insanity, the prosecution has the opportunity to have their person examine the one charged. In Pennsylvania, it's not so. The prosecution may have a psychiatrist who observes only in court and reads everybody else's material, but cannot examine the person himself. So it depends on the place. I would take issue, though, with you, Cy, because I don't think it's so difficult. I'm called by the prosecution very often by the other side, by the court often. I think if you build a reputation of being a neutral, honest individual that does not have an axe to grind, is not either prosecutorial orientation, or you don't have a defense orientation, I think people will trust your judgment, and I have gone into court.
People being who?
People being
jurors,
the
judges?
The attorneys who will call, so that if an attorney says, I want Sadoff, for any reason, the other side may say, well, I know he has a reputation of being honest, I can trust him to see my client, or whatever. There are times when I see a person for a defense attorney and I say, I'm sorry, I can't help you. Now, he doesn't call me, but he may find somebody who can help him. I may see somebody for the prosecution. I'm saying, look, this man I think is insane. Well, doctor, if you say so, you know, we'll have to go along with that. That's fine. Then they walk him through. The judge may ask me to see him because there are two people on either side and he has to break the tie. And very often, I'm not blowing my own horn or patting myself on the back. I think, though, that the science or art or discipline of forensic or legal psychiatry has to take a neutral stand. One cannot be adversarially oriented and succeed, because otherwise you have hired guns. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we should have that kind of a proposition.
You would concede, Bob, that it's an awful lot easier when the judge asks you to do it.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Explain, Ms. McGinniss, if you will, the extent to which this judge did rely on people who had professional background in psychiatry.
Well, this judge in the McDonald case relied to no extent whatsoever. What he did do, when the defense attorney sought to introduce testimony by psychiatrists, which
no.
would have indicated that McDonald, in all probability, did not have the capacity to have committed these crimes, the judge said that if the defense was going to introduce that kind of testimony, the prosecution then had a right to have McDonald examined by psychiatrists, psychologists of their choosing. And so he underwent an examination. And the results of that examination were, as I mentioned before, directly opposed, couldn't be more opposite to the conclusions reached by the defense psychiatrists. And the judge, looking at what report was prepared by Dr. Brussels and his associate, Dr. Silverman, in 1979, looked at that, had quite a bit of awareness of what the defense psychiatrist would have said, and said to the attorneys from both sides that I think that this is simply going to confuse the jury because we're going to have two guys over here and two guys over there, and they're going to argue with each other, and they're both going to say, one's going to say he couldn't have, the other's going to say he could have. I shouldn't say couldn't, but one's going to say in all probability he didn't, the others are going to say in all probability he did. Let's just stick with the facts and stay away from this area of opinion. That the judge found it to be another form of character testimony. Mm-hmm. To have a psychiatrist mm-hmm. say, I don't think this man could have done this, is not much different in that judge's eyes from having a nurse who worked with him in the hospital for 10 years say, I don't think he could have done it.
Okay, now let's take this and run with it for a moment. You have some very interesting passages in your book, which I'd like you to recall. Here, you became a very close friend of this guy. You lived in the same house with him. And here they're getting ready to put him up to trial. And Ms. McGinniss sets out to write a book on this. Slowly, you come to the conclusion that you're dealing with a man who's absolutely guilty. Question: did you use intuitive psychological skills to arrive at this? Or did you simply yield under the pressure of what you consider to be overwhelming circumstantial evidence?
I'd say that the overwhelming circumstantial evidence first caused me to recognize that there was a very, very real chance that, despite outward appearances, he must have done it. I felt perhaps not beyond a reasonable doubt at that point, the circumstantial evidence...
That would have struck either of Dr. Sadoff or Dr. Halleck exactly the same way. Up to that point, right?
Well, it certainly struck the 12 jurors exactly the same way.
Yeah, okay. Okay, then what?
Then, in living with him during the trial, in seeing his emotional reactions and lack of emotional reactions to different situations, you could say that in an amateurish way, for I claim no credentials in this field, I had an intuitive psychological insight that the man was not responding appropriately in circumstances. Let me give you an example. Throughout the summer, in private, he would rage against the judge, against the prosecuting attorney, against witnesses called by the prosecution, against the military from 1970, rage against everybody in the privacy of the fraternity house where we were all living. When he was first confronted in the courtroom by the woman who, according to his own story, participated in the slaughter of his wife and children 9.5 years earlier, there was an absolute absence of response. There was a blankness there. There was an emptiness, a void. I even asked him about this. I said, how do you feel seeing her after all these years? You know, there she is, just, you know, right across the courtroom from you. Where was the anger here? Why wasn't it directed toward this person who, by his own story, had committed these crimes?
If somebody's capable of sang-froid, he can sometimes lapse from it, can't he? Take, for instance, the response of the woman who killed the doctor, the woman who's head of that school, Madeira.
Jean Harris.
Yeah, Jean Harris. Now, Mrs. Trilling, in discussing that episode, said that what struck her with great force, she having gone in thinking that the woman ought not to be legally guilty, was, once again, her apparent indifference to the atrocity of what she had done. I'm asking you simply the question, is this something that you spotted that Dr. Sadoff or Dr. Halleck would not have attached as much attention to because of their more considerable experience?
Well, I don't know how much attention they would have attached to it. I know that it struck me as very peculiar and bothersome, and in light of, alone, isolated, as an instance, I wouldn't have placed a great deal of... I mean, from the first moment I saw Jeffrey McDonald, the first thing he did was make a joke to me. He says, I understand you're an expert on triple homicides, and he left, making reference to a newspaper column I had written 15 years earlier about a student at the University of Pennsylvania who had been accused of killing three people in a fraternity house fire that he set.
And you say, I understand you're a specialist in child
expert,
abuse?
Well, I didn't say that at all. I said, good morning. But it struck me as most peculiar that this man would be making jokes about this kind of a situation. It struck me as most peculiar that he would be allowing his friends to give him a disco party to send him off to North Carolina on an emotional high, as he put it. A lot of things struck me as peculiar, but I'm perfectly willing to give the man the benefit of the doubt. He's been under suspicion, under duress for 9.5 years. Who am I to analyze whether his response is appropriate in a vacuum?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, when we get to the courtroom, and when for 5 weeks we see detail piled upon detail piled upon detail, when we see all these details woven into a web, I say, there's no way. He had to have done it.
Yeah.
Then certain emotional responses or lack of response take on, to me, added significance.
I take it you don't doubt that that would have been the evolution in the thinking of professional rather than amateur observers of this man.
Well, I couldn't speak for professionals. But I would say that anyone, I would say that no one who I know who attended every day of that trial
thought him innocent.
Thought him innocent. Uh-huh. The 12 jurors took only 6.5 hours to convict. There was no newspaper reporter who covered the trial who I know who thought him innocent. There was no one who was present day in and day out who was subjected to that evidence who thought him innocent. And the appeals court, when ruling upon the correctness of the verdict, said that they found ample warrant for the verdict of guilt. There's never been anyone who's been exposed to the facts who has doubted the accuracy and rightfulness of the jury's verdict of guilt.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
I don't want to talk about the guilt or innocence issue at all.
No, no.
It is very clear that whoever gets involved in this has to eventually psychologize and try and construct some picture of a motive, or what kind of person this
sure.
man was.
Dostoevsky's job.
And certainly in Mr. McGinniss's book, he does construct the psychological picture of a man. And without being rude, I would say it's amateurish. I would say that you saw a lot of things and you were probably convinced of them, but I don't think you really had the background to be able to evaluate those.
Well, see, I don't evaluate them in the book. All I do is I give you column A and I give you column B. I say, here are characteristics which other people who have written books, other professionals in the field, such as Otto Kernberg, for one, with whom you might disagree, but there's disagreement among psychiatrists, there's disagreement among authors, disagreement about among political commentators even. But I would say, here's column A. These are characteristics which others would say define a man as being pathologically narcissistic. This syndrome contains at its very root a boundless repressed rage against the female sex. This is not my conclusion. This is the conclusion of experts, you know, who could qualify as experts in...
You would have to be experts because a non-expert wouldn't know what you're talking about.
That's right.
That syndrome is not even recognized by the official nomenclature of the American Psychiatric Association.
Oh, really? I mean, this is a concoction, this is a
pathological narcissism is in large part Dr. Kernberg's and Dr. Kowat's idea. There's a narcissistic personality disorder, which is listed in our diagnostic and statistical manual, but not pathological narcissism. It's a highly speculative area.
Well, as is the area of trying to determine whether somebody is capable of doing
it. I think you have to look at the total picture. If you see a person out in the field, like yourself, who's working, a normal individual, and you give the reaction that Joe has seen, he may speculate about that. But I think we have to look at the source. We're looking at a person who had been charged and under pressure, who lost his family, a lot of different areas, and then a person with a kind of a background. I'm not talking about him, but let's just speak in general. When you evaluate a person, who's been charged with a crime, I think it's a different totality entirely. Mm-hmm. You have to look at it differently. And that's why I think people who have the experience in dealing not only with people who are normal, people who are psychotic, people who are psychopathic, the people who go out and steal and rob without thinking about it, but people who have been charged with crimes generally, they have a different way of viewing things. They have a different way of looking at things because their life is now under pressure. It's a different situation, and I think they will react in a way that we have to look at not only what is he doing, but what is the context in which he's doing it in. Yeah. Without doing that, I think, unfortunately, Joe, we do get a bit amateurish. And I
no. Well, what strikes me as extraordinary about this case is that, with the exception of the psychiatrist hired by the prosecution in 1979. Everyone who has examined this man from any point of view has, with differing degrees of weight placed here or there, come away saying he falls within normal bounds. Mm-hmm. There is no evident pathology here. Mm-hmm. That's what, to me, makes this case so bizarre, so fascinating, so horrific.
It's inscrutability.
Is that it is inscrutable. Yeah. How that question is unanswerable.
Sure. For instance, we wouldn't want to form any opinions that we would call experts, say, by contrasting the stoicism of Mrs. Kennedy at the funeral of her husband and the behavior of Prince Rainier when Princess Grace died. One obviously had a capacity for stoicism, but the other did not. It was no gauge whatever of the sense of loss. So that's the kind of thing that an amateur is given to that an expert probably shrink at.
That's a good use of word.
But let me ask you to comment on something that a professor of psychology at Georgetown, Daniel Robinson, recently said. It's quite a mouthful, so I'll stop halfway through and then go on. Clinical psychologists and psychiatrists have expertise only in the textbook sense of knowing the history of that somber speculation that gave form to their disciplines. Their predictions of future violence are in error at a rate of about 90%. Their internal agreement on diagnostic categories is no greater than we would find among professors of economics. Their theories are wanton, and their opinions are self-congratulatory. Their methods are no more scientific than is pastoral counseling, or for that matter, the late night TV sermonette. Since there is no settled body of fact, no settled and reliable methods of measurement, and not a single theoretical term that has ever been vindicated by accepted modes of scientific verification, clinical psychologists and psychiatrists cannot be said to occupy a space within which expertise can flourish, and where there cannot be expertise, there cannot be expert testimony. Would you agree with that?
I would agree with some of the premises, but not the conclusion. I think that he's right when we say we cannot predict dangerousness or violence with any degree of certainty. And I think we argue that as a part of the American Psychiatric Association in a recent case. And the court said, we don't agree with you. We can tell when you can tell when a person is going to be violent. And you go ahead and you give the expertise and the judge will make the decision. I would agree with him when he talks about our ability not to agree on diagnoses as well. But I don't think you should throw the baby out with the bathwater. I think the
You think courts, he's doing that?
I think he's doing that because what he is saying, because we cannot do it textually, we cannot do it academically, therefore we should not do it practically or in a clinical sense.
Oh, no, he earlier grants the services of clinical psychologists in many fields.
Even in court, I'm talking about court.
Even in court, I see.
In court, I think we can, and we do offer, I think. And you know what? If we weren't able to help the courts, I think they'd stop asking us. I mean, from the standpoint of reason, the standpoint of practicality. And when they do stop asking, I'll stop going. I don't go because I want to be there. I go there because I enjoy it, because I think I can do something for them, and I think psychiatry can offer something for them. I can't speak for psychology, and that it has helped in many cases to have psychiatric consultation at various stages of the courtroom procedures. Maybe not in terms of who did it, whether he's insane, but what's the best thing we can do for this individual? Does he need treatment? What can we offer him? What does psychiatry offer in the prisons? What does it offer on probation? What does he need besides chemotherapy, that is the use of medication, or psychotherapy? Can he use vocational counseling? Can he use kinds of...
But surely Dr. Robinson here is using the term expertise with some formality. He's asking whether your level of predictability can ever reach 100. Now, for instance, I can say, if you stick a magnifying glass between the sun and my hand, I'm going to feel heat.
Yes.
I can say that with absolute certainty that nobody will ever be able to confute this. Now, what can you say in the field of psychiatry?
I can say definitely we will never reach that stage of certainty. And so what?
Well, can't you predict, for instance, that the desertion of a child by a mother will cause loneliness?
In whom? In the mother
child?
Or the child? In the child. Probably in both. It may. And in some, it will cause relief. In some, it may cause relief, and it may cause the person to have a better upbringing because the mother may have been unworthy and maybe a bad mother, and somebody else will pick that child up and perhaps do a better
job. What then
child.
Should we do with the word expert?
I think expert is not 100%. I think that's the point. If he is making...
You mean Gallup can be an expert sophologist, but he can't tell you he's going to be elected president.
That's right.
In that sense.
Okay. That's not a bad analogy.
So therefore, you would be useful in counseling jurors or judges on the... On what, for instance? Let's take a case we all know, Hinckley. Okay. From what you know about Hinckley and that phenomenon, what could you usefully say to the jurors? Would it have to be within context of D.C. law?
Yes, within the context of the not only the law, but the rules of testimony, the rules of evidence. And I would have to know those. I see myself every time I go into court, Mr. Buckley, as a teacher. Mm-hmm. That's my role, because I'm only called as an expert because I may know something by my experience or my training that the average intelligent lay person doesn't know.
But doesn't your teaching function activate an advocacy function, even as Socrates was both?
It does, but you see, that's neutralized by good cross-examination. And I have said before that there isn't any psychiatric testimony that cannot be effectively attacked by good cross-examination.
Well, how come you don't need an expert to examine you? If for instance, you have hold of a body of knowledge that a prosecutor simply has never mastered, how can he effectively challenge you?
He gets a consultant of my background and training who will then advise him how to cross-examine me, as I advise my lawyer how to cross-examine their expert.
He also gets someone who he retains to come in and say exactly the opposite. I mean, if you have, as we said earlier, this is often, almost always, an advocacy proceeding. If psychiatrists are hired by the defense, then you can be sure that the prosecution is going to go out and find psychiatrists that they can hire to say something that will confute what the defense psychiatrist
But I want to say this. They may go out and try to hire one, and they may want someone to refute on the opposite. Sometimes they don't. And sometimes what they find is their experts agree with the experts for the defense. People don't talk about that, and I think it's very important that the public know that we psychiatrists do not always disagree.
Mm-hmm. Let me just add to that, then, talking about the Hinckley case. Psychiatrists can tell the court in what way an individual is incapacitated, and can define those capacities, and can even give some indication of how those capacities impaired ability to choose or not to choose one or another course of behavior. And generally, they're very much in agreement on that, no matter which side they're on. And if you look closely at the Hinckley testimony, it is not that far off. This was one of those rare cases where there was a great deal of disagreement between the defense and prosecution. But if you, I've talked to most of the psychiatrists involved, and they really were just yay much off. They were not that much different.
But can you tell the court whether or not an individual is incapacitated?
I can talk about the kinds of incapacities. The reason I wouldn't testify in the Hinckley case is because I can't tell them how much incapacity should absolve them or should exculpate them. That is a decision for the judge and the jury. It's a moral decision.
Well, but you read the law, and you are convinced that he falls within the framework of those who should be immunized by that law, don't you become an advocate in trying to communicate your teaching knowledge to people who know less than you do, i.e. the jurors?
The main thing I advocate when I get on the witness stand, which is very seldom, incidentally, is to try and get people to believe what I think I see are the incapacities in an individual. And what the jury wants to do with that is up to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think advocate is the right word, not adversary. Too many advocates become adversarial. I think that's the problem.
But if you have two advocates who are advocating conflicting contentions, you have an adversarial advocacy.
And you have an adversarial role. But I think when you find the psychiatrist who is really an advocate becoming adversarial and arguing instead of teaching, then I think he's lost his point.
If you're saying it's very easy for a psychiatrist to get carried away, mm-hmm, and become an advocate and an adversary, mm-hmm, It is extremely easy for that to happen, and that's a real risk.
Well, one man's teaching is another man's argument. I mean, that's a semantic, you know,
sure.
What may appear to Dr. Sadoff to be teaching, from his point of view, may appear to the people on the other side of the aisle to be argument.
Well, let me ask you this. How do you gentlemen govern, how do you set up a code that binds your professional practice? The lawyers attempt a code, and the doctors attempt a code, and the psychiatrist. I remember about 30 years ago, some psychiatrist appeared at the trial of Alger Hiss, and he gave on the basis of watching Whittaker Chambers on television or something for 5 minutes, a thorough profile of him, which was shot down in a matter of minutes. I think the psychiatrist must have retired the next day. in any event, do public episodes like that cause you to deliberate and attempt to come up with a code of behavior that your fraternity is supposed to be bound by?
I'm glad you asked. Yes, we have an American Academy of Psychiatry and the Law, about 800 of us in the country who are interested in and work in the field of law and psychiatry. Then we have an American Board of Forensic Psychiatry, which examines people who are interested over several months, I guess. We have about 150 people who have boards in forensic psychiatry. And there are codes people learn. There are ethics in forensic psychiatry. For example, is it ethical for a psychiatrist to examine a defendant for the prosecution before the defendant has counsel appointed? Or is the examination by the psychiatrist intrusive enough that it could lead to a guilt finding before he has an attorney? Who can advise him, don't talk to that psychiatrist because he can get you in trouble.
That would not be a matter for lawyers to judge.
But it's ethics on the part of forensic psychiatrists, too, that we should not involve ourselves where it may be illegal or it may be unethical on the legal part.
There are some ethical things that are just excruciating and probably unresolvable because you're often using your empathic skills, which were developed originally totally to help people, and then turning around and communicating what you learn as a result of using those skills to an agency which then uses that to harm the individual. We haven't resolved that.
What do you mean by harming an individual?
Well, let's say you
examine... Bringing him to justice?
Bringing him to justice, denying them an insurance policy, denying them entrance to a school.
Yeah, right.
We often get, and it's not only forensic, we often get into roles where we interview somebody where we are employed by an agency. And the patient assumes, sometimes wrongly, that we are simply there to help them. And in the course of our interview, we interview them using the skills we ordinarily use in helping people.
Right.
And then we may have to be in a position where we turn around and say something to somebody that is not helpful to that individual.
Yeah, but surely your professional skills were never thought of as being confined to helping individuals, right? I mean, at the service of justice, broadly defined, is certainly a professional goal, yeah. Is it not?
I would see it as that.
I don't see why there's a built-in conflict.
Well, some people feel that as a psychiatrist, we're trained in medicine, and as doctors, we should have the patient's interest at heart only. That is the person that we examine.
And the patient's interest in this case would be not guilty.
Even a defendant. That we are the agents of the defendant, then, of the patient, and not the agents of the prosecutor, of the court. But you see, I don't think that's true, and I think we have outgrown that whole concept. But there are some psychiatrists who want us out of the courtroom who say, we are doctors. We should never involve ourselves in these administrative problems that take us away from that doctor-patient relationship where our only goal is to help the person we serve.
Now, who decides whether that point of view gets inscribed in your code of conduct? This 800-man board?
We're still battling that one. That's an ongoing battle.
Hasn't been decided yet.
But I mean, eventually, that's where it would get decided?
I don't think it'll ever get decided. I think it's one of those problems that will just never be resolved because there'll be a number of us who will go in there, I think, into court because we want to and we feel we can do the job. There'll be others who, for reasons of their own, feel we should never be in court.
And in which case, the individual psychiatrist can continue to follow his own conscience in the matter.
As long as he does it within the bounds of ethics and law, yes.
Well, give me an example of something that would violate your standards. And get you sort of excommunicated.
Well, for example, I think if a psychiatrist in a domestic relations problem where he has to see mother, father, and children where there is a custodial issue, if he sees only the mother and the children and not the father, and he says to the court, these children belong with their mother. How does he know? He's never seen the father. I think that's an ethical problem, where he's making a comparative statement based on insufficient data that a competent psychiatrist would not do.
Or in divorce proceedings where mental cruelty kind of stuff and improvisations there.
Yes, or if a psychiatrist treats a family and says, now look, I want you to be honest with me and open, and doesn't tell them, look, one day I may go into court and testify against one of you and for the other, and therefore I want you to tell me everything, and they do, and then one feels betrayed later on because what he opened up to and told that psychiatrist now is being used against him in court, so he doesn't get his children.
Or if you see a defendant and fail to inform the defendant that as a result of this examination, certain things may be said about him in court, will not be favorable.
Well, Ms. McGinniss, we only have 5 minutes, but and it may be late to mention this chronologically, but what did happen was that this doctor was investigated by the Army, which set out to prosecute him, and then they decided that, in fact, he was guilty, and they let him go. Years went by, and
they decided that he was not guilty.
He's not guilty, and they let him go. Years went by, and substantially under the prodding of the father of the dead, or stepfather of the dead woman, the feds got interested, the state got interested, and brought it back to trial. Now, Mr. McGinniss, would you say that the 10-year deferral of justice here was directly the result of the intervention of the psychological instrument?
I think that the Army hearing officer in 1970, who recommended that the charges be dismissed as not true, it is a matter of now public record, that in his recommendation he cited as, if not paramount, certainly high among his reasons for his conclusion, his degree of being impressed by psychiatric testimony from psychiatrists employed by the defense and by a team from Walter Reed, which did not go as far as the defense psychiatrist, but which said, we can't come out and disagree. We find the man to be within the bounds of normality. And the defense psychiatrist, and it's a matter of public record, was Dr. Sadoff, who said, in my opinion, I don't believe that this man committed these crimes. Mm-hmm. Colonel Rock in 1970, who was an amateur in the field of psychiatry, was tremendously impressed by that. He cited that in his report. In 1979, Judge Dupree, also an amateur in the field of psychiatry, felt that there was no place for this kind of testimony in a court of law. The rules of evidence were different between the military hearing and the final.
Well, you say it figured prominently in the decision to throw the case out. Would you say it figured decisively?
Well, you'd have to ask Colonel Rock that, and he's for 13 and a half years he has refused to speak about his recommendations or his rationale. But you can only go by the written report which he filed, in which he emphasized the degree to which he had been persuaded by the psychiatric testimony, which indicated that Jeffrey McDonald probably did not have the capacity, or certainly there was no likelihood that he would have committed crimes of this sort.
So now, what organic reforms do you recommend based on what you have in hand here, i.e. a case in which justice was deferred and only accidentally ultimately consummated as a result of the administrations, in this case, of psychiatric evidence?
Well, I think that we have two systems of justice working here. We have the military system, which, of course, in a preliminary hearing, the rules of evidence were much looser. In civil law today, in criminal law, where Jeffrey McDonald was finally convicted as a civilian, the law as it currently exists is much stricter, at least in federal court, about the uses to which psychiatry can be put. And I think, as I said earlier, quite justifiably, Judge Dupree felt that to have these two gentlemen or any two other gentlemen come in.
You mean stricter in the exclusive sense?
In the exclusive sense, yes. Uh-huh. To say, don't bring me an expert who's going to come in here and say that somebody couldn't have done something. Mm-hmm. If you want to come in here and we all agree that somebody did something, then you can bring in your expert to say how he might have done it because he was under duress, he was temporarily insane. We can talk about
that.
This
would be in attenuation.
But you can't plead a sanity defense as opposed to an insanity defense. You can't say, I didn't do it because I couldn't have, and then hire a psychiatrist to buttress that.
Now, would he have said the same thing if the prosecution had said, frankly, Your Honor, every single psychiatrist I've looked at or conversed with agrees with Dr. Halleck and Dr. Sadoff. Would he then have considered that the preponderance of psychological evidence would become a factor with which the jurors should be acquainted?
Well, the basis for his ruling, as he stated it, was the disagreement between the opposing teams.
I'm saying if there hadn't been disagreement.
If it hadn't been disagreement, it's entirely possible that he would have allowed that testimony. It's entirely possible that that testimony would have been very persuasive, again, to 12 jurors, none of whom is professionally trained. They tend to take expert testimony very seriously, whether it comes from a criminologist, whether it comes from a psychiatrist. Once somebody is classified and passed on and approved as an, quote, expert, the jurors tend to listen more attentively, I think, to what that person has to say.
So you're not going to nail some theses on this particular wall and say, from now on, X, Y, and Z should not be permitted?
I wouldn't go so far as to say psychiatry should never testify in a courtroom, but I would go so far, I would say that I think on the basis of limited exposure to an individual, it might stretch the bounds of credulity to say that an individual, one man, is incapable of committing an act of violence. If you talk to somebody for 3 hours, whether you're a psychiatrist who's been trained for 25 years at the New York Institute, how can you say this man is not capable of committing these acts?
Especially when you have something as aberrational as this to deal with.
That's the very point.
Thank you very much, Mr. Joe McGinniss, author of Fatal Vision. Thank you very much, Dr. Sadoff. Thank you very much, Dr. Halleck. Thank you very much, ladies of St. Joseph Hill Academy.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.